you know, this symposium, and then of course the exhibition itself, is around the idea of not just who am we, to requote Dovo Su, but what can museums do to help us answer that question? And given that we're looking at museum as practice, I think it felt entirely appropriate for us to end with two people who are practitioners of the museum. So the structure of the next 45 minutes or so is going to be the following. I have asked both Alistair and Charles to introduce their practice to us. And then have sort of, we've been bouncing around a number of questions around how museums can show friendships, what museums do in terms of exhibitions and collections in narrating nation and interrupting those narrations, and what does the position in Eindhoven and Manchester allow for these sorts of positions. As I'm sure most of you already know, Alistair Hudson on my left is the newly appointed director, well, it's no longer new, no? It's a year old period, of both Manchester Art Gallery and the Whitworth, previously of MIMA, Middlesbrough, and then an institution that we've referred to a couple of times, Grisdale Arts. So I think there's some sort of interesting connections to draw out, as of course the sort of commitment to the idea of useful art in the museum being a useful space. Charles Esche is the director of the Van Abbemuseum, but also a professor at the University of Arts London, and a curator of large exhibitions all over the world. And somebody who's been really sort of, I think, playing a pivotal role in sort of the project of provincializing Europe. So I think there are some of these things that we will pick up. But what I wanted to start off with, and maybe Alistair, if you can kick us off, is you have 5 minutes to tell us about your practice as a director.
I might not cover it all, but what I thought I would do is I've got 10 slides, and I thought I would do a CV in buildings. So basically, I'm going to just show 10 slides of the 10 buildings I have worked in as an employee, but where basically I have been considering basically not only how you work in a building, but how you work on it. And something that I trained as both an artist and as an art historian, so I always had this sort of muddled idea of what the hell I was doing. And I think this idea of thinking of the museum, the art gallery, the institution, as a process in time and space, not as a fixed autonomous entity, is very key. But also one that any institution is created by basically the sum of its constituencies of usership. So that every institution is created by a set of relationships, some of who have more power at certain times than others and have more interest at certain times than others on very different scales. So to illustrate, really, so this is my first job, which is the Henry Moore Institute in Leeds, which whose constituent group is primarily art historians. If I'm cynical, the public never go to it. It's designed to look like a castle. It is the fortress of art. The next place was, this is the British Pavilion in Venice, which was, that was early 90s, Richard Hamilton. But yes, this being the constituent group of this building being primarily the art world, and in reality the art market, for the most part. This is all rather serendipitous. This photograph by Richard DeMarco of Joseph Boyce in an Audi outside the Anthony Doffé Gallery with Sandy Nair and Heiner Bastian, the art dealer, and Anthony Doffé and the widow there. And I worked here for quite a longish time, which obviously is a commercial gallery then, one of the biggest commercial galleries in the world, dealing with big blue chip artists, big names, with a constituent group of people who buy art, the 1%. Everyone might want to describe that, and this was very informative for me about what I wasn't interested in some ways, as well as what I was interested in. So the leap from that was this building, which is the UK government home office headquarters, which I worked on with the architect Terry Farrell as an employee of the government art collection, on a scheme with the artist Ian Gillick and a number of artists to do a public art strategy. And interesting, a building that wasn't an art gallery. And it was basically a building that was largely closed off to the public, although it had to use art in order to communicate to the public, and was in effect a project about how we get government to think about itself aesthetically. And also this idea of a working environment filtered over to the next kind of chapter of this decade of working at Grisdale Arts in the Lake District. This is the headquarters, Lawson Park Farm. Again, not a building that's open to the public and not a gallery. It is a workspace, and it was interesting hearing about, you know, sort of the ethics of LYC as being founded on work. And a lot of what we developed at Grisdale was this idea of an institution that worked within constituent frameworks of that particular village, that particular community in the Lake District, working with international artists from China, US, Africa, wherever, but also with local practitioners, whether they be artists, craftspeople, farmers, cookie rug makers, lace makers, builders, electricians. They were all considered part of the project. And this really was about the institution operating in ordinary life and doing things that were useful as an antidote to the usual rural fantasist residency about escape. It was about coming to a place to work and to make a contribution, whatever that might be. And yeah, it was funny seeing LYC, the mended wall was, it kind of brought back memories of trying to hold this 13th century farmhouse together in lots of different ways. And this is also really where I suppose this idea was developing around useful art, or arte util, as we kind of also referred to it, art as a tool, which is sort of where we had an introduction to Charles, and that led on to the things Charles might talk about as well, but really developing this international network of like-minded people that were interested in breaking art outside of its 1% constituency and into everyday life. That led on to working in this building, which was in the same village in Coniston, which is Coniston Mechanics Institute, which was John Ruskin's early stab at a kind of varied art and life institute. So this was basically a museum collection, library, bathhouse for the miners, community kitchen, lace making, wood carving, copper repoussé, crafts workshop, hybrid, built in the kind of 1870s, which we then sort of set about rediscovering this history, which became very informative in terms of, again, a lot of the things we might discuss in a minute. The jump from that was really to here, this is Middlesbrough Institute of Modern Art, a brand new Starkitect Dutch designed building with a regeneration agenda in probably one of the most deprived towns in the UK, or I use the deprived in inverted commas. And the idea was to kind of how you would repurpose this building, which was designed for autonomous art world, and to make this kind of community centre, in all the ways we've been discussing today, work in a place like Middlesbrough for people who didn't give two hoots about the world of contemporary art on a whole. And then latterly, obviously, that idea then sort of generated a body of interest, which led to the idea that we might take on, or I would take on the role here at the Manchester Art Gallery, at the Whitworth. There's an old photograph of the Whitworth as the Whitworth Institute and Park in Manchester, a useful museum of its day, which was really about A, making a better life for people in the city, because it has a park as well, like heart, mind, lungs, all that, but was purposely about using art and a collection to turbocharge the cotton industry of Manchester to make it a more productive economy and to make people more creative. And interestingly, if I go back quickly, the Manchester Art Gallery, also founded in the early 1820s, was again a building without an art collection. It was an education centre about introducing creativity into a town that was then growing into a city at the kind of central heart of laissez-faire capitalism. It was about a corrective, about creativity. So it's not such a big jump from the LYC, I would argue, as you might think. And then finally, the other building which is under my watch is this one, which is Platt Hall, former slave owner's mansion in South Manchester, just beyond the Whitworth, which is was up until recently the Gallery of Costume, but we're now repurposing as a new idea for what an art institution might be. But we are developing that with constituents or users within the local context, the village of Mossside, Fallowfield, Rushholme, rather than deciding from curatorial directive. Great,
that's a great
spotted history. Mm-hmm.
Charles?
Yeah, I'm not going to compete with that. But what I thought I'd do is try and talk a little bit about how I see more or less 25 years, I think, of practice from the mid-90s, relating to certain developments which also parallel, I think, developments in society, or certainly in political society, I think. So when I started, I think, which was actually in Tramway in Glasgow, more or less, I think one of the ideas that I think drove me was an idea which later came to be called new institutionalism, which I really didn't like at all because there was nothing new about it. But what I wanted to define it as, and would like it to be defined in a way, is a sort of experimental institutionalism, which is, I think, was an idea that the institution itself, the art institution, could be reshaped or reformed according to not only the needs of artists, but also according to the needs of the curatorial. And I think it was very much at that stage, if I look back at it now, it was a kind of top-down approach in which the artists and the curators, and still maybe the idea of the avant-garde, lingered as a notion of an experimental area which would lead society, yeah? Because you have to, the avant-garde has to know which direction the army is moving, otherwise it's not an avant-garde, it's just an isolated unit. So essentially, this idea of the avant-garde, I think, still lingers around the idea of what I would call experimental institutions, in which I've played around, I suppose, most specifically within the Rosane. I think the idea there was in the name of the experiment was to create possibility which didn't exist otherwise. Yeah, so to understand it, in a sense, to scan the artistic field of institutions and how they worked, and to see what was lacking in a certain sense. So the experiment was not so much simply in a formal sense or in an artistic sense, it was also to understand what might be absent, and to focus on the absent. I think that that's been, to some extent, a running, is to go against the time, to go against the trend. And I think art at its best is often the thing that goes against what seems to be the most modish activity that's going on at this particular time. So I think that this experimental institutionalism kind of segued into, I mean, when I first started in Van Abbemuseum, which is now 15 years ago, so a long time ago, was something that I referred to at the time, and I'm writing a PhD at the moment, which sort of divides this, so that's why I have it sort of in my head, what I called democratic deviance at the time. I remember that's what I wrote my application about. That the institution should understand, again, what the democratic majority was wanting and try to do the opposite. So you have to understand that democracy is not the rule of the majority. Actually, democracy is the permission of minority voices to have a public platform. And that's something I think that we're in danger of losing very often in our understandings of democracy. But it felt to me that then the public institution, I was always invested in this idea of public, which is a sort of old-fashioned social democratic, or had become a sort of old-fashioned instrumentalized, I would say, by social democracy as a recognition of state funding and the fact that it was somehow in not necessarily in place of the market even in collaboration with the market, but that it offered an idea of the public as opposed to the entirely private activities that were going on in Anthony Dockhead, for instance. But I think that sense of publicness, not so much in that social democratic sense, but more in the sense of a platform which is open to antagonistic encounters, yeah? Because the public is an antagonistic whole. Yeah? We don't go together nicely most of the time. We talk about friendships and we talk about how those connections happen, but they're always rough. They're always struggling to coexist. They're struggling to coexist, and in a certain sense, that struggle to coexist can be played out in a way. I think that Chantal Mouffe called at the time friendly enemies. Yeah, that the institution of democratic deviance could be a meeting of friendly enemies, and that became to me more and more to mean a meeting between the artists and the public, in a certain sense, which were often friendly enemies as well, but also the institution of the art. That actually there was an antagonism between the curatorial and the artistic. And that antagonism is something you shouldn't try and either smooth over or you should try and understand the curatorial as a facilitator, or simply as somebody who is there to serve the artist. That actually there's a curatorial and an institutional position, and there's an artistic position, and they need, in a sense, to rub roughly against each other, and they need to struggle, and they need to fight. So this idea of democratic deviance became not only deviance from the mainstream, but also within the organization itself. Again, I think largely figured around the person of the artist and the idea of the avant-garde still, but that there should be a sort of roughness around those encounters, that we should push each other. And that, I think, produced many projects which I could talk about, but we don't really have time to go into details. I think, and to some extent, I think that mirrored a society from the 90s up until, we could say, the financial crisis in 2007-08, in which it, you know, I think particularly in mainland Europe, which I was working, I left the United Kingdom, I left Scotland, should have been in the United Kingdom, unfortunately it is, but I left Scotland in 2000, or 99. So really most of this experience is really from Sweden, and then also with Biennales, as you said, and then the Netherlands. I think there was a kind of an understanding that, I remember an Indonesian artist, who's now doing documentary, actually, I just realized, but Indonesian artist Ade Dawaman, who told me when he was at the Rax Academy at the end of the 90s, he said, you know, it's really difficult to make art here because there's no problems. And there was this idea, I think, in the 90s in mainland Western Europe after 1989, and this supposed idea of victory of a sort of liberal democratic, which became a neoliberal version, but a liberal democratic version of the world at the time, this end of history story, that there weren't really very many problems to solve. There needed to be some fine tuning, and there could be this and that needed to be changed, but essentially within Western Europe, things were sorted out. And so therefore this idea of antagonism, of friendly enemies, of democratic deviance, felt like an urgent provocation to that idea that basically everybody could go along swimming and that things were all right. Because it was clear that things were not all right. Already issues of climate change were present, but also inequality was accelerating. Yeah. And we know now that inequality has gone back to the time of Ruskin. You know, we're much more in circles, I think, than we are in lines. Maybe to cut a long story short, we then moved to, or I think what happened after, particularly after the crisis, and also the cuts that came, which was a sort of driving force to rethink, I think, our raison d'etre in a way as a public institution. Cuts in the Netherlands were around about 35-40% at a certain point. And I know that I think you've gone through this similar kind of figures here more recently. But in that sense, I think we began to build, and this is where Arte Utile and Constituent Museum come in, an idea no longer of building on this avant-garde, which had by this stage completely lost any sense of being in the forefront of a society that was moving in the same direction, but had really become simply a minority, which was defended only, or was defensible only in terms of its legacy, and you know the vague hope that maybe we might be right, but it was more or less like a speculative system in the economy, where you're sort of going to try and bet on a company that's going to be the next Apple or whatever. But there was no sense in which there was really an avant-garde, in which there was a whole force coming behind you to support that avant-garde. I don't think society was going in 25 different directions, and it's continuing to. So that model of the avant-garde doesn't work. But I think that for us, this move back, if you like, into the body of the society, very much was shaped by not only the cuts and the crisis, but also an understanding that avant-garde was no longer sustainable as a raison d'etre, and had become the preserve, really, of that 1%, largely, and a sort of moneyed avant-garde, rather than anything which was ideologically loaded. And then I think the Constituent Museum and Arte Utile, which you've already introduced, became very much the sort of leitmotifs of how you might develop a program in an institution and what that institution might mean, which means, of course, to listen, which means to understand that there are different voices and the curatorial needs to take a back seat in that, no longer necessary to be ideologically driven, but to try and define what principles are, where the lines are that you would draw. And I think, you know, issues of social justice, of equality, perhaps equity, an emancipation. I think that those are sort of fundamentals that we should try and preserve from, if you like, the modern. And then I think the final step, which we're in at the moment, and that I'm sort of very caught up in my own thinking around this museum, maybe we'll talk a little bit more about it later, is the question of how to demodernize Europe. You talked about provincializing Europe. I think also one of the responses to this sort of trend for the decolonial, which I fear is a sort of temporary trend that's sort of interesting for a few months, and then freeze or move on to something else or whatever. Because the decolonial fully applied means an end to patriarchy, capitalism, and colonialism. I mean, it's the whole system needs to be undone if we actually decolonize. And I don't think that's what's being proposed when freeze do their reader. So in that sense, the answer I think that we might need to do as white, as old white men sitting here, one of the things that we can offer is an idea of the demodern, the idea of looking at the modern itself, which is presumed to be the carrier of the emancipation, equity, equality, social justice, and actually understand that it's not the carrier, it was just a convenient vessel for a certain period of time, but those qualities existed in other and exist in other cultures and other forms of thinking, and that maybe separating those values from the modern, which is so complicit with the colonial and so complicit with the dark side of modernity, as Mignola talks about it, that it's no longer useful for us. It might have been useful at a certain time. It's not to rewrite history and say everything was wrong, but it's to say that now the modern has become a weight on our backs. And of course, as a modern art museum, which the Van Arnhem Museum is, we can talk about that maybe a bit later, that raises a whole set of new set of questions about its goes on there, its right to exist.
Well, thank you. And I think what some of these concepts that have just been raised, so about usership, the constituent museum, about the experimental institution, about the public, I think we can also try and reframe within some of the themes that we've been running through as we apply to the LYC museum. So if you think about the exhibition and the publication literally as being modes of finding a public, as modes of addressing and conversing with the public. Mm-hmm. As we think about, well, we've literally talked about place. So but in both your formulations, place and the public that you are then conversing with or seeking to encourage to the users. And then lastly, that notion of friendship, which if we then think about, what is the role of the museum? Which child is going to come with their muddy boots into the Manchester Art Gallery, make them a cup of tea, do some drawings, and then leave? So I think if you then think about what you've just described through that lens of the LYC that we've just been looking at, it would be great to think about what that constituent museum, and we don't have to name it, but whether it's in Manchester or in Eindhoven, what would that look like? How would it function? What would it say, and what would it invite from these users?
Well, I also think one of the ways to think about this is to think is against this idea of autonomy, mm-hmm. as well. That the institution, whether it's a gallery, a shed in a park, or a huge museum, is that they are part of an infrastructure that is being created socially itself. So we have to lose this idea of it being this kind of isolation chamber, this place that you step over the threshold to somehow enter this neutral gallery space. And then actually, the myth of neutrality is a key challenge, I think, that we're kind of facing at the moment. But actually, if you start to create methodologies in which you can reintegrate the infrastructure, so you were involved in housing, you're involved in politics, you're involved in, parking or education for 0 to 5 year olds, then you start to create a different value system by which you can be judged, or which you can have those conversations and relationships on a daily basis. And instead, you start to reverse the polarities, as I call it, of the normal ways of working, as the Charles has described. So rather than trying to get people to come to the museum and join in art, you actually are looking for how the institution can join in society, and what is it that you can do with and for amongst other people, just as citizens yourself, so that you're no longer, the authority figure, but you're just somebody trying to have a go at making things work, just like everybody else is. And that joining in is actually, again, going back to this idea of work, I think a lot of projects I've been involved in outside of the normal framework of the performative frame of art or the 1%, is when you've actually shown that you're working, then you then create those relationships and those understandings that are really fundamental and really important. And I think that applies to an individual, but also to an institution as well. That if you're seen as an institution being working towards something, that you're making a contribution is the equivalent to when somebody in a little village in, you know, North Cumbria or Cumberland says, you know, says, oh yeah, I get what you're doing. No, you're, at least you're joining in, you're contributing, you're making cakes for the village hall, or you're helping us mend the fence. It's a kind of similar mindset, I think.
Yeah, I think, I mean, I want to preserve an idea of political autonomy, but not necessarily artistic autonomy. I don't think interesting, unless it performs a role within making your own rules politically, being able to construct a sort of deviance away from the democratic norm, if you like. And I think that still has aspects of the autonomous. So I wouldn't want to lose the autonomous entirely. At the same time, I agree that the way that autonomy has been domesticated, in a sense, by modernism into this kind of playpen idea, in which you can do your art over there, but essentially it shouldn't have any impact outside of its own zone of influence, is highly problematic. So we need, in a sense, through those connections, to actually demonstrate an autonomy which can be useful outside of the zone of art. And I think that's very much what we're struggling with. I can give you one example of what we're doing at the moment, which I think is quite good in that relationship, in that we're working with a group of people who are really, and I don't know whether this happens in England at all, but they are asylum seekers who've been processed to the point where they have been told they're not going to get residency. But they're not actually removed from the country, at least not actively. So they basically then sit in this twilight zone, and they can exist in there for decades, without unable to work, but at the same time able to stay. And there's a certain basic idea in the Netherlands of everybody who's in the country having a certain right to bed and board, I think, to roof and board. So. And that would be something that those people we've been working with recently, with a couple of our guards, basically, who are from Afghanistan, who also went through that process but came out the other side with the permission to work. And we have a small space, a tea room, called the living room, which Sandy Hilal set up, who's a Palestinian artist. And there they serve tea and basically become a guest, which is the only moment that they have this possibility to be a guest, to be a host, rather than to be a guest, to be a castor, to be somebody who gives hospitality rather than takes hospitality and demands. And I think the conversations which are emerging out of that, it's an artistic project in the sense that it has a particular aesthetic of a cross between a kind of Ottoman, Arab, Afghan living room. But in that space, something else is starting to happen over the last period. And I think that's for people who come into the museum, it's actually a good example of what a sort of constituent museum could be, because that's run relatively autonomously, I'd say, by the group themselves, who come and go and organise themselves. It gives a certain capacity for those random visitors who come in, who never know who they are, who walk in through your door, to actually tell their stories, to the point that at one point Shafiq, who's one of the guards, met the Dutch ambassador to Afghanistan, who happened to wander in. And then he started talking and said, yes, I know Afghanistan quite well. And then he turned out to be the Dutch ambassador, completely coincidentally. But those kind of exchanges would never really happen without this space. And so I think that's a kind of, it's an artistic project. It's I think, a way of, it's almost the LYC museum, in a certain sense. It's this meeting of different cultures around a cup of Afghan tea, in this case, rather than Chinese.
There is a difference. I'm going to say the last thing, and then I'll open it up. And the difference really comes from, I think, something that you pointed earlier, which is that you're both sitting on collections.
Yeah.
And those collections, although most of them live in stores, those stories continue. Mm-hmm. And those stories, and I think it was Isan who quoted John Dewey, so, art makes community, community makes us.
Yeah.
What responsibility does the constituent museum have to interrupt those
maybe
stories?
I can start that, and then because mm-hmm. I think it's the reverse order. I mean, we're a modern art museum. Essentially, I won't go through the whole history, but essentially, our history is one that was unvidedly, I would say, imposed by the Museum of Modern Art in New York, more or less, in that the first director took that model of the Cubism and Abstract Art cover of the book made in 1936 and adapted it for the Van Abbe. And in the Netherlands, and I think also in Germany, at post-war, the American-occupied part of Europe, essentially, this was very, very common. Less so in this kind of, perhaps because it was occupied in a different way by American culture, but we in the Netherlands were thoroughly occupied in many ways, which I can talk about endlessly. But that process, in a sense, means that as a Museum of Modern Art, our collection is a very narrow slice of the experience, not only the 20th century, but also completely excludes the longer stories of art, which could be told going way, way back. And there were other models of what the Museum of Modern Art could be. So we can put Alexander Dorner and Alfred Barr next to each other, and we can understand two possible models of the Museum of Modern Art. The one that won was Barr's. We can say, and we can understand why, but maybe it's no longer the appropriate one to have only a modern art collection. And I think that for us, we're borrowing the Goya and the Hogarth, which is quite radical for us, although it would seem very transparent for other people. But also, you know, the LYC collection with its Roman remains as part of the collection, with its sort of, you know, almost you could say folk art aspects or craft elements that were coming in through the hook drugs and things like that. I think in a way that's a much more vibrant example of a collection today, and maybe ones that are actually more common in England than they are in Europe now. And I think we have a real challenge to understand what our modern collection means. A lot of our exercise is to try and initially just take a distance from that modern collection, from that modernity, and to try and understand that this is a history which we can respect, which we can bid farewell to in a certain way, in a very polite way. Yeah? It's not about insulting it, but understanding it's no longer of our time. It's not now. The modern is not now. And I think that process also fundamentally would affect the identity of a modern artist.
And in a way that it's a slightly more luxurious position, I think that's quite acute in Manchester as well with these specific collections that were built as collections on collections by different people with different interests at different times in their history. So you do have folk art, you do have textiles, you do have things from, you know, archaeology, you know, you have a whole guddle of stuff, you know, which is amazing, and was designed as this toolkit. It wasn't designed as according to Barr, because the UK in a way resisted this idea for a long period of time. It was part of its sort of island status to a certain extent in opposition to Europe. So that we've, in a way, accidentally landed with something close to a version of where we want to be, that was already in place. So a lot of this is about uncovering actually the true intentions of these institutions that perhaps in the UK has been suppressed by the modern in order to sort of, you know, conform to that regime, etc.
And I think it's also this sort of circular time that we look at. So, you know, Ruskin building a road would seem to be incredibly contemporary, if you want to call it that.
Socially engaged art practice,
yeah, that would come all the way back. There would have been a long period where it was not seen in any terms as an artistic practice. It's now come back. I think when we talk about autonomy, if you read, you know, the arguments around 1968 in Art Forum, you'll find these same arguments being engaged with. Yeah? So these things are also not, and nothing that we're doing is new. That's why new institutionalism is rubbish. But the idea that these ideas come back, and maybe even the idea of the rural, I'm thinking of Catherine Byrne's recent book, even the idea of the rural, which disappeared, you know, for a certain time, to the extent that I know that the sort of English art history, you know, the YBAs, it became an incredibly urban phenomenon, yeah, in a certain way. And, you know, now we're going back to look at Banks and Cumbria, because that circle is coming round again. And we can look at something else, maybe almost a form of resisting commodification in the same way that that, you know, in socialist Europe, artists would go to Pavel Buchner himself, actually, when he was in Czechoslovakia, who's sitting at the end, would go to outside of Prague to make performances and make things, because that was the place where these things could happen, because in the center of the city there was surveillance. So in a certain sense, the commodification of art is also a form of surveillance, you could see, in which the rural returns as a form of escape from that.
But also in that, not just the rural, but also the non metropolitan as well.
Yeah.
Because actually, and then once you start looking and you start digging and you find like LYC, you find these strands with it where it's there, but it just needs revealing. And if you think about, you know, what the, you know, the kind of Bauhaus diaspora was doing in the 1930s, and you look at Dartington Hall and things at Black Mountain, and even where I was in Britain before, there was a sort of rural offshoot, Bauhaus offshoot relationships between the Manchester settlement in Ancoats here in the 19th century with Jimmy and Jane Addams in Chicago. Mm. There were these networks. There were, you know, of people basically doing this other version of art that was somehow canonized within the, you know, it was sort of adopted or taken into captured is probably the right word by the modern project. But suddenly we're in this moment where actually by looking again we just start to reveal these threads are actually something quite different.
And on that moment of capture, I really want to open it up to the audience. We can continue talking for hours, but we don't have any of those. So I thought we'd just sort of bring in questions.
I just wanted to say, building on that idea of the collection, just to put a little bit of context on that, at NYC there was the moon relics and there was all the other activity. But there was always this, Raphael Soto, a kinetic piece. It was just very delicate, just hanging there.
Yeah.
And that was in amongst all the chaos out there, the drawing machines and stuff. This beautiful piece. Nick, who owned that? Next one, Mr. Okay.
It was in the first room.
Yeah.
You couldn't miss it.
Yeah.
I think it might have been on the sky crack.
Yeah. Anyway, that's what I just want to see. Add colours of them.
Yeah. I want to mention also, of course, the Hammad Museum or the older museums in the Netherlands are not free back here. That's a huge difference. You know,
yeah.
How many people walk around here or just come in?
When we did the Museum of Art and Tulip at the museum, if you entered as a spectator, you had to pay.
Yeah.
But if you entered as a user, it was free.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have played with that a little bit. But
Architecture has a lot to play, a big part of the playing system, because all the buildings that you're now in charge of, and these are big, kind of, you know, in a sense they are reflections of power.
Mm.
Very, very different from, if you're talking about creating an atmosphere, creating a kind of dynamic, you know, which is a kind of meshing of unlikely participants. I think architecture is massive. But it's a difficult thing to overcome, I think, in some senses.
I often feel that it gets most interesting when, like with the Museum of Art et Art, which we did together with Tanya, that there's an element of squatting that's going on. We're misusing the architecture, because the architecture is built for certain purposes, and the repurposing of that architecture doesn't necessarily mean it's destruction. Yeah? You could actually repurpose it, but repurposing it would be to treat it with some disrespect.
But also I think people get the idea of the institutional power as well, and I think it's not just us that enjoys playing with that as well. Other projects, I can think of historically where working with, for example, people trying to get legal status as a resident or asylum, these people
but
in between.
Even Tanya, is Tanya Bruguera, the artist whose project at Tate Irvine Hall was renaming a building, the Natalie Bell building, who's a local activist, whereas the building opposite is the result of tens of millions of pounds. So I think just that kind of...
That's the same thing I was kind of moving towards, which is actually people understanding that institutions like this can be a route to talk to power, right?
Mm-hmm.
So even if you are most disenfranchised or however you're sat in a position, we can create the conditions in which people can see the art institution and museum as a way to get things done or to have a voice or you know, the who are we question in places where you can't do it anybody else. And so I think that that has huge potential in terms of this usership model. That if everybody can see that they can use the institution in one way or another, it doesn't exclude anybody, including still the 1% and the collectors and the art, and that's still all in play, that's still there, but you have this wider range of activity as well, which can also kind of find inroads and pathways to the institution as well.
I think that's something that's marvellous about Manchester. It grew rapidly, swallowed up things like Platt Hall and lots of others, even as far as Withenshaw, and those halls are now preserved and some are in museum use, or got quite good doors on them if they're not in use at all right now. But the thing is, that's the thing about, it's not the only British city that did that, it grew rapidly, which means that the places where those buildings are now, it's the fall down bit of the inner city, it's where your immigrant communities arrive and your minority communities arrive, and they're still doing that here. And your asylum-seeking communities, of course. And that means those people are all on foot. They have to be.
It was very interesting.
And that's what's great about this. So
the discussions we had with Platt, for example, we've been doing these sort of community discussions around
neighbourhoods around.
They loved the idea. It was a slave owner's house. So it was like, you know, let's bend this. Let's turn it. Let's not deny that. Let's play with it. Let's, like, you know, let's kind of manipulate that from our perspective as, you know, kind of people who come from different cultures or
These are the people who need integrating. And I was talking with somebody who tour guides, but he couldn't seem to fathom why people from the north side of Manchester, he said, they've never been in the art gallery. They only live 3 miles away. I said, yeah, but unless they're culturally present where they live, they can't be culturally present in the centre. And that's missing, actually, particularly from the north side of Manchester. I don't know any historic houses up that way. That might be my mistake.
Queen's Park.
Yeah.
Oh, right, OK. But that makes a difference. Whereas at least we know we've got this one on Withenshaw, that, you know, it's getting your newer communities in through the doors. And, yeah, you're right, other talk to power. But most cities can do that because of the nature of the rebuilds that happened from 1830 on.
I was wondering, you're talking about architecture and the building of museums, like the buildings that have museums. I run a museum that's a pop-up museum, it's a museum for young people, but it's a very small project. And then I guess I'm interested in, like, the notion of a museum without a building. So, for example, museums like the Museum of Homelessness, museums and suitcases, this kind of new interpretation on it. It's more of like an open question of what's your kind of feeling around that kind of new iteration of the museum.
I would ask you a question about it's a new concept because Marcel Duchamp did a suitcase, like he had a museum and a suitcase.
With that kind of without space or with movable space, where, like, do you know what I mean? That kind of.
I think we have to remember that museums are quite a young, new thing, and in a very particular, with a geographic focus, you know, came out of predominantly a kind of Eurocentric culture as well. You know, there's a lot of art that's happened historically in the world without museums. So they are a product of the modern project, if we define the modern project as beginning in, I don't know, you know, 1480. So I think we have to remember that, but we also have to remember them as being, you know, this is why I think it's important to remind ourselves that they're not fixed, that they're constantly changing, they're constantly evolving, and they're just as fluid as any sort of pop-up or any, you know, things come and go and they change and they become something else, and that's okay. And of course you can have all those things, the world is much richer for having all those things at the same time rather than one or the other. So I think what we need to do is acknowledge the spectrum of activity. Now, of course, the balance within sort of politics and economics is that normally the big institution gets all the, has the gravitational pull. You know, the bigger it is, the bigger the gravity. So I think we probably have to find ways to work, you know, to accommodate those other practices, which I think, you know,
I think also it's about who gathers around those. Let's say the collection in a suitcase or something like that. It's the collection itself is only as good as the people who gather around it, in a certain sense. Yeah? It's the gathering and the sometimes antagonistic relations that spark that, that are sparked by that collection. And I'm sure that happens. Yeah? I think the collection itself is a wonderful tool to create the kind of, you know, agonistic relations, which are the fundament of a kind of democracy that's not the rule of the majority. So it's very important that they happen, but it's important that they're not just phenomenon in themselves, but they have a social life, in a way. And that social life, I think, is how we could judge them. So in a sense, the same in the museum. I think museums can be totally deaf, you know, with their collection. And museums in suitcases can be totally dead as well. They can be simply, you know, individual projects. It's about what this gathering.
Case.
It's what this gathering takes.
But in terms of this gathering, and I think this is a question really to both of you, and also because you're both operating in Manchester and Eindhoven, so cities which are not the capital, in countries which both, shall we say, have moments of questioning belonging. Mm-hmm. And again, those circles never go away. You think about, oh, it's 50 years since Enoch Powell, and that seems suddenly, you know, very resonant. And so just thinking through, and you described, you know, how you're addressing the local with say, Platt's House, or with the Afghan refugees, mm-hmm. or, you know, the asylum seekers. And I wonder, what is the responsibility that you feel as people, you know, having, practicing museums of intervening in the sort of the national conversation of mm-hmm. belonging mm-hmm. that we've talked about.
I think, I mean, we did a project a few years ago called Becoming Dutch, I think, which was more a kind of provocation in a way, because it was in that period, I suppose we started it before the crisis and then it ended up being just after, but it still felt like a moment where this idea of Dutchness was relatively unchallenged, and there were reviews of that exhibition which said, why are they bothering asking these questions about identity? The reviews felt rather silly because we already had a kind of a you know, we could say is a proto-fascist or a popular, you know, right populist movement already moving with Pim Fortuyn and later with the Geert Wilders. So it was already underway as it was, you know, what happened here leading up to Brexit, I guess you could see is more or less the same thing, sort of rejection of the outside and redrawing of us and them lines. But nevertheless, that was a little bit within the art world. There was still this sort of what I would characterize as complacency towards what was going on outside of that art condition.
I think the big conversation now, really, internationally, nationally, is really how you get economics to work, for me, in the broadest sense. Mm-hmm. So economics as in how you maintain a society.
Yeah. So equality, that right. relationship of political economy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So for me, I suppose what I'm interested in doing here, and we're trying to do, is to create projects, ways of working, where you test out models for that to work, and it might be within Rush Home or Moss Side or here in the city centre, but with particular constituent groups, because you cannot generalise. You have to work in specific circumstances, but then those case studies can then be part of a national, international conversation with everybody else who's trying to, you know, tackle these things. And to join those up.
But there's also an internationalism in the place that you're in, and that's what I think Becoming Dutch revealed to it. And we recently put two maps on the wall as you go into the collection, and one is the diversity of origin of the citizens of Eindhoven, and the other is the diversity of origin of the collection. And the diversity of the citizens of Eindhoven is far greater than the collection. What's interesting is that the narrative, because Eindhoven is a relatively small city of 200,000, the narrative of Van Abbe was always that it's an international museum in a provincial place. But actually this shows that the collection is far less international than the citizenry of Eindhoven itself. So suddenly we're a provincial museum in an international city, actually. And our collection is provincial, if we talk about collection, within that context of the city that we're meant to be reflecting. Yeah? That's also, in a sense, our taskmasters in a certain way. Yeah?
Yeah. There's a wonderful parallel, actually, to the case that we were talking about of Cartwright Hall, whose collection, you know, is sort of pride of place in speech acts, where there was a political act to kind of address exactly that,
yes.
That relationship that you're talking about,
yeah.
is how does a collection reflect or talk to demographics?
Yeah.
I'm just scanning the room here.
Well, do you think we're doing this project this summer? It got announced today, actually, because it's part of the International Festival. Here with Tanya Bergera, we're going to run a school for integration. But it's basically people from other cultures teaching, theoretically, the local people about their cultures. So it's like reverse assimilation. And in a way, that's sort of it's about how you use the resource like this to actually say, actually, this is a city with close to 200 languages spoken. But if you came on a daily basis and maybe looked around, the galleries, you wouldn't necessarily know that. But buried in these collections and buried in the resources, there are those stories, as speech act shows. But it's how we tell those stories, and we need to have that collective conversation, which is inclusive, in order to bring that through. The truth, really, the reality of the complexity of how culture works.
And I think it goes back to how we use our resources is one of the things that we should be judged on. So it's like not to give up on those large scale institutions and say let's do pop up museums. It's both and. Yeah? It's also that we need to respond to your kinds of initiatives and to use the resources that we have historically until we don't have them anymore. to actually use them in constructive ways that can support the kind of dialogue. So I think that's why we still do what we do in a sense, because we feel a responsibility to make use of those resources in the best ways that we can.
Annie?
Thank you. I mean, that's really interesting to hear from the perspective of the institution. And I guess in the spirit of their deviant disobedience, I just wanted to ask, because we've spent a really wonderful, rich day talking about Liu Yuanqiao's practice and his alternative sort of institution, and he's very much sidelined and forgotten till different occasions that it's popped up in this wonderful endeavor to bring him back into the narrative. And with all due respect, I also kind of feel slightly uncomfortable. We're ending the day with like such a strong institutional presence of two very respected male white leaders. Yeah. And I wonder how we can disrupt that as well, this kind of plenary that's always there.
You're doing it.
But also, I think, my colleague here, her point is really getting back to the whole, how do we decouple the museum as a forum with the institution as a sort of basin of power or an instrument of power? And I wonder how we can open that up more, whether it's through conversations like this and other forums.
I just wanted to go because when we were talking, I was reflecting on the fact that...
Oh, sorry, let's just finish.
Oh, sorry, yes.
And also having more people of colour and maybe other women who are leading that sort of projects into the panel, perhaps, yeah. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I just wanted to add to your comment. I think the notion of a museum is what seems persistently useful, because when you mentioned the Pop-Up Museum, the LYC Museum, we're talking about museums and we're looking at building particular architecture and wondering exactly, I suppose, the same sort of questions that you were just asking, what's useful about this discussion, and is it that the notion of the museum is still useful? I've just been thinking a lot about an institution where it defined itself in opposition to the idea of the museum, and whether or not that's helpful or not. So I suppose, could you answer that question about, is that notion of the museum something that's useful to you and your practices? Is it something that's helpful to you?
Well, it's still
why
useful,
did you use
but
it?
I want
yeah.
to think about how we can expand the notion of the museum. So apart from just the institutions with the buildings and the collections, which themselves have to be very institutional because you have to protect collections and therefore you need resources. Therefore, we need political power to have all those things come together. But how can we also fracture that somehow to have other modes of museums within museums, perhaps, or even the word museums of the future, which I think you were talking about how we could have museums without forms and how other forms of museum could happen through digital, perhaps. I'm brainstorming here, but it's been a long day and a very rich day, so and a wonderful night last night as well. So it's. I guess what I'm trying to say is that how else can we open up these conversations where they are so much about policy and really set a tone perhaps for how things move forward, to have other voices, other other persons from other communities with other interests to also join in that question of what is the museum, perhaps. Yeah.
If I could just jump back on that one, and I think it does bring us back to LYC a little bit as well. It's a very clear example of something that works just by doing stuff. You know, it really discovered what it was through doing and making. And for me, that is actually where the bread and butter of this is. So yes, of course, we sit in these fora which obey the traditions of everything we're criticizing, right? So we've got the projector, we have the layout of the chairs, the podium. You know, this has all the trappings. But I think actually what I would say we're trying to do as institutions is to actually break those habits. It's about changing behaviours. Mm. So whilst, you know, the architecture of the building kind of stays the same, you can bend with it and play with it, but that's the framework. But there are lots of ways in which we can, just by doing different kinds of things, start to develop different behaviours and patterns. And I think that's where we get to the point where, that you're talking about.
That's which, really exciting.
Yeah, so it's quite hard to talk about that. Because that is just talk. And actually, I think if you see the texture of, for example, some of the things Charles has described, the interpersonal moments, like, you know, the conversation between the two Afghans in the museum, that's actually where what you're talking is taking place, because Charles isn't there necessarily in that conversation. Those people are allowing themselves to take over the space in a different kind of way.
But I mean, I agree with you, and I struggle enormously. I mean, I'm struggling with my own privilege constantly in that relation, and I'm not sure what to do with it, because my privilege is not necessarily only personal. Mm. It's a privilege which is sustained by a structure. Mm. And if I were to resign tomorrow, it's not necessarily true that that structure would be overturned.
No, I agree, and I wouldn't want you to resign because you're doing fabulous
job. But I think it's a very legitimate question to ask, and I think I should.
But perhaps it's not
soon.
Resign. Perhaps say, can I bring someone else with me?
I mean, I think that's what I think there are attempts to do that, but I think the structural change, which in a sense is the decolonial, is the end of patriarchy, capitalism, and colonialism. This is what the decolonial or decoloniality implies. That's the challenge. You know, the Holy Trinity, if you like, of these three which coexist and which can't be separated. The three are dependent on each other. And I think that in those terms, that's the structure that we need to change. Now, what I can contribute to that as somebody who's benefiting from all three all the time is hard to imagine, except for me, the question of the demodern, which feels like something which me, as a privileged subject of the world, owns that narrative. That's my narrative. It's the museum's narrative, but it's also in I embody it. Yeah, I embody the modern man. And so to try to demodernize that narrative and myself to some degree does mean allowing other voices, absolutely. It does mean thinking about diversity in terms of the staff, which we think about very hard. Does mean giving people who, does mean changing your aesthetic radar radically. From a modern aesthetic radar to other kinds of understandings of what art could possibly be, including some of the work that we've seen there that's not necessarily named art today. And I think that's what the LYC Museum actually was doing, as Alistair was saying, just by practice and not necessarily by any other kind of rhetoric that I'm giving you now as a white person in power. I understand that really.
We should think of yourself as a museum yourself. It's like you're the building, you're going to repurpose the building.
Yeah, yeah, but I mean, what would be nice is we could change the structure sufficiently that when I resign, it doesn't just repeat itself. That would be great.
And this analogy of bending is quite nice. I think our friends in Poland used to bend it. So you keep bending. At certain points, it snaps back. But if you keep, it's like steaming wood. If you, at some point, it starts to give, it starts to grow in another place.
And I have to sort of bring at least the formal bit of this conversation to a close, because we've gone well over even our 5:15 limit. But as an example of bending, and it may be a very small bend, but I do want to sort of acknowledge, I think, the openness and generosity of Manchester Art Gallery to host both the exhibition and this event. which in a way is also inviting exactly this kind of difficult conversation that we don't have enough of, you know, which is around who speaks, for whom, how, in what form, and how do we open up those conversations? And I think sort of, you know, Annie, also sort of, you know, you and the artists that you curated within the gallery space itself, with some bends here and not enough bends there, I think is very much part of that conversation. And I sort of want to sort of leave it there with the metaphor that I'll sort of take from Tai Chi. So, you know, in Tai Chi, which is both a form of moving meditation, but also a martial art, to practice the martial art, you do something called pushing hands, where the purpose is to find the center of the person that you're playing with. And when you found it, you push them even a little nudge and they'll go flying. So I think we have to push hands with the museum, with middle-aged white men, with middle-aged brown men, with whoever you wish to play with. But I think the key thing that we can take away from Lee is three-way ping pong table is that it's really important to play. Thank you all for playing with us today, and maybe continue in that spirit. Thank you.